Now, let me show you a similar scenario, essentially, of how distortion in phase now impacts the waveform. And I'm going to start similarly to what we did for amplitude response. I'm going to start with a case where I have zero phase distortion. Zero phase distortion means that my phase response as a function of frequency should be perfectly linear, which will yield the normal flat group delay, as we like to call it. So again, I'm using the signals where I have three discrete frequencies at the input that basically all yield a nice waveform for me. And I will assume that basically omega 1, omega 2, and omega 3 are all along this line. So when that's the case, when this is true, your output waveform, which is this red one here, is simply a time-delayed version of your input. So nothing bad happened, simply you basically suffered a time delay, which is something we don't care about. On the other hand, let's take a case where that's not true. And unfortunately, in most filters we synthesize, the phase response will not be linear. It will actually be something of this nature. And so that means that omega 1 will suffer some certain delay, and omega 2 will suffer different delay, and omega 3 will suffer different delay, and unfortunately none of them are on the same line. So when that happens, look at how your waveform now becomes. It's not just a time-delayed version of the input, it's actually a distorted waveform. And again, you have to worry about what does this mean for your signal-to-noise ratio. On top of that is because of things like this, where, for example, you will see in different textbooks that you might send, let's say, a very sharp pulse at the input, and at the output, it will be a pulse of this nature. And that is, again, a serious issue that has to be fixed.